Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. Coming up on this week's show, a ton of mobile device news. Nokia's CEO sends out a scathing memo, and we beat up a gadget. We'll start this week with mobile news and a lot of it. First up is HP that launched a tablet and two smartphones this week. All of them run the latest version of WebOS, acquired last year when it bought Palm.
This is the HP Touchpad. This is the first in what will be the WebOS touchpad family. For the first time, WebOS is showcased on a form factor that lets the intuitive elegance of the platform really shine through.
The touchpad has a 9.7-inch display and comes with e-reader software and the ability to print photos right from the tablet. It comes with 16 or 32 gigs of storage and a 1.2 gigahertz Snapdragon processor. The Wi-Fi versions will be available this summer in the US and select markets worldwide, with the 3G and 4G versions coming later. The Veer smartphone has a 2.6-inch 320 by 400 touchscreen display and a slide-out keyboard. It'll be available in early spring. The Pre3 has a 3.6-inch 480 by 800 pixel display and a 5 megapixel camera that shoots HD video with stabilization, as well as a front-facing camera for video calling. All three of the devices can be charged wirelessly using the Touchstone device. iPhone 4 came to Verizon stores this week, but there wasn't as much fanaticism as with typical Apple launches. The scene at the Apple store this morning in Boston was more or less deserted, with no one waiting in line. Down the street at the Verizon store, only about a dozen customers braved the below-freezing temperatures. One customer had been waiting in the cold for nearly 2 hours.
Because I just want to get it now. I'm going to roll back into bed until class. So I just wanted to get it so that I can actually get it today and not have to wait like till next week, till they... Because they're probably going to run out today, or at least I'm assuming, so...
Sprint launched a new smartphone that has dual 3.5-inch touchscreens and runs Google's Android. Called the Echo and made by Kyocera, the two screens can run separate applications.
With Echo, you can do two completely separate things at the same time. Or you can play your favorite game or watch your favorite video with both screens combined, making this device almost like a mini tablet, but one small enough you can put into almost any pocket. Echo allows you to run two apps simultaneously and independently on two separate displays, and you can search the web on one screen while checking your email on the other.
It has a 5-megapixel camera and can shoot 720p video. The phone runs Android 2.2 and is powered by a 1 gigahertz Snapdragon processor from Qualcomm. It will be available around April or May for $200 with a 2-year contract on Sprint's network. With still more mobile news, Sony Ericsson unveiled its first Android-based PlayStation phone during the Super Bowl this past Sunday. The Xperia Play has a touchscreen and slide-out PlayStation controls. It remains to be seen whether Sony Ericsson can find a market between regular smartphones and dedicated gaming devices, and one analyst said that by combining the two product categories, you usually end up compromising one side or another. More details on the phone will be coming from Mobile World Congress in Barcelona next week, and we'll be there. The European Commission announced its first common mobile phone charger. Europe has 500 million cell phones, and old chargers generate more than 51,000 tons of waste each year. A common charger will be reusable even when switching brands.
The new mobile phone common charger is a major step forward in technical terms for our industry and means that consumers will be able to use their common charger with various mobile phones and other devices compatible with the micro USB specification.
The European Commission pushed companies for a single charger for years and in 2009 issued an ultimatum: voluntarily adopt a common charger or face new legislation. 14 major manufacturers jumped on board. They represent more than 90% of the phone market in Europe and include Apple, Nokia, Samsung, and Sony Ericsson. The common charger should begin appearing later this year. Nokia CEO and former Microsoft exec Stephen Elop sent out a memo to employees this week comparing the company's current situation to standing on a burning oil platform in the North Sea. He wrote that Nokia must decide how it's going to change its behavior or perish in the flames as the platform burns. The memo doesn't explicitly say that Nokia will get rid of existing software platforms and adopt either Windows Phone 7 or Android when it announces its new strategy on Friday, but the writing is on the wall, according to analysts. Staying in Europe, WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange is now in the midst of an extradition hearing in London. According to testimony on the second day of the hearing, text messages sent by the two women who accuse Assange of rape and assault mention revenge and economic gain. His legal team presents the accusations of rape and assault as a veiled attack related to the WikiLeaks release of secret U.S. diplomatic cables. He has not been charged in the U.S. A few weeks ago, you saw me shoot up a hard drive at CES in Las Vegas. Well, this week, there aren't any guns involved, but we did get to put this device through its paces. It's an Omni XT10 from Scion, and is an enterprise-class device designed for the supply chain and logistics market. It's tough, too. It can endure multiple drops from 6.5 feet. It can withstand up to 30 minutes of direct water spray from a high-pressure hose. It can operate in temperatures from negative 20 degrees Celsius, or negative 4 Fahrenheit, to 50 degrees Celsius, or 122 Fahrenheit. We replicated those conditions by putting it in the freezer for 30 minutes, and in the toaster oven for 10 minutes. After all of the tests, it had no problem operating. The only damage we were able to inflict on it is a few scratches on the screen from some keys. It runs a Texas Instruments OMAP 3 processor and carries an IP65 rating. It's also modular and supports up to 10,000 configurations. It costs about $2,400 and is available now. NHK, Japan's public broadcaster, gave us a preview of tech projects that might be coming to a TV near you in the future. Providing a new way to look at underwater sports is the Twins Cam. It solves the problem that traditional cameras have because of the way light refracts differently in air and water. The Twins Cam solves that problem with two cameras, one underwater and one above water. Both of them have their zoom and focus synchronized to produce a single realistic image. NHK hopes it will be used at next year's London Olympics. Hoping to size down the typical broadcasting truck, NHK has managed to fit most equipment into this electric car based on the Mitsubishi iMiEV. It can switch up to 4 video sources and send back a live signal. The car battery provides a 100-kilometer range, and a second battery will power the equipment for up to 2 hours, and we're looking into getting one. Well, just kidding. Well, that's our show for this week. Next time, I'll be coming to you from Barcelona, where I'll be for Mobile World Congress. We'll also have video for you of a computer that competed on Jeopardy. It's a show you won't want to miss. As we head out this week, we'll leave you with some shots of IBM archive footage in celebration of its 100th anniversary. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching, and we hope to see you next week from Spain.